Greetings, blessings to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ on this wonderful, blessed Sunday evening. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ once again. This is David Jones, Worksmith Ministries, live broadcast here on Facebook platform to share with you the Word of God for this evening. A lot has transpired since the last time I've been on this platform, so there's very much a lot to talk about. I pray that your week has been a blessed week and that you are staying safe in all of His ways. This is the day the Lord has made. Again, I will rejoice in it. So we're happy today. We're glad that we are still here. We're still in the land of the living. We have a portion of health and strength on today. And we're just glad to be alive, quite frankly. The Bible says that the world is passing away, but he who does the will of God will abide forever. And as you're seeing today, the world is in a very chaotic condition. Things are just going spiraling out of control because of this system, the system that has been implemented and designed by man, will one day collapse and fall. It is not eternal. It is temporarily. But those of us who are doing the will of God, we will remain, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and we will enjoy this blessedness that will soon be given to the children of God. So tonight, I want to share with you from the scripture what I feel strongly, a word, just a word. And that word tonight is blameless. Blameless. That is a word that I feel strongly to share with you on this evening. The scripture text that I'm going to be coming from, if you do have your Bibles, if not, just follow along with me, would be 1 Thessalonians 5:23. And this is what the Bible says. He says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." So Paul here is writing to the church at Thessalonica, and he is encouraging them to be blameless, not only in their sanctification, but their whole spirit, soul, and body. So there's a process in all three areas of our life that God is calling for before the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, that we may be found blameless before him. Now, this is not a common word. At least I haven't heard this talked about or preached in Christian circles today. Nevertheless, that's not to say it hasn't been preached or talked about, but it is an uncommon word. It's not talked about because for the most part, the church is not blameless. Many Christians are still struggling against sin and struggling in sin. Many Christians today are living a lifestyle of sin, of unconfessed sin, and walking in unrepentance. So it is not a common word to be blameless, probably because most of us are not. But the Bible is calling for a people to become blameless, or to strive to be in this atmosphere of blameless. It says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul be preserved blameless at coming of the Lord." He goes on, he says, "He who calls you is faithful." In other words, God is a faithful God who will also do it. So this work that will be produced in the life of the believer by the Spirit of God to produce a life of a person being blameless. To be blameless is simply to be without fault. It is a faultless lifestyle. When you say, "Preacher, that's impossible for us to have a lifestyle and to be faultless." I would differ with you. The Bible understands that some of us occasionally will come short of the glory of God, for all have sinned. Nevertheless, that is not an excuse to live, to try to pursue a lifestyle that would be pleasing unto God, that would be without fault, so that you may become a blameless and a harmless children of God, without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. I believe we're living in that generation today. I believe we're living in a generation that is crooked, a generation that is perverse, crooked, and perverted. Crooked meaning because they do not know the straight and narrow way. They're not walking in the way in which God had called them to live or to walk in. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father except through me." So there is a straight and narrow way in which God is calling us believers to walk into, to live a lifestyle into, and that way is a blameless way. Christ also said on one occasion, he says, "Enter in by the straight and the narrow gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, but difficult and narrow is the way that leads to life, and there are few who find it." In other words, Christ is saying that there's a way in this generation that you can walk into that's wide, that's broad. It's the in thing. Everyone's doing it. It seems right. It feels right. It looks right. But that way is a way of destruction. That way is a way that can lead to eternal condemnation. But straight and narrow, we're talking about a straight and narrow path of life. A path that is so narrow that the Bible says that it is difficult because there's challenges. There's adversity. There are trials. There are tribulations, that obstacles that would come in this path of life. Therefore, is difficult for some, because some simply just fall away from the straight and narrow way. They do not pursue. They do not press into this narrow way to the gate that leads into heaven, and they fall aside and they begin to wallow in the broad and the other way. So there are more souls in hell, I believe, than heaven. For the scripture says, "For many are called, but few are chosen." In other words, the call that God places upon humanity is evident. Everyone will have their chance to receive Christ in their life, whether they be in the church or out the church. Everyone will have that chance to receive him in order to enter into heaven's glory. Many are called, but there are few that are chosen. Few that answer this call. Few that follow and walk in obedience to this call. Man has corrupted his way since the Garden of Eden. This crooked and perverse generation is a corrupted generation. Listen to what God said. He said, "Man has become like one of us." Now, he's referring back to the garden in which God commanded them not to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. You know the story. They did eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And their eyes were opened up, and they knew both good and evil. God says they have become like one of us. Prior to that, they did not know evil. They only knew good. He says, since the fall of mankind, his thoughts were continually evil. Deuteronomy 32 and 5 says they have corrupted themselves. They are not his children. Because of their blemish, their perverse and crooked generation. This is that generation that refuses to obey the truth, refuses to follow the principles, to obey the doctrine and the word of God. Perverse meaning they've corrupted or they've turned away. There's a generation out there that knows what to do is right, but they refuse to do it. The world has turned their ears away from hearing the truth and have believed lies. This is the situation.